Pause.
All good faith when you're up on the mountain.
Talk up so easy.
tough comes so easy.
When life's at its best.
When life is at its best.
Now it's down in the valley.
But down in the valley.
Trials and temptation.
Trials and temptation.
That's where your faith.
That's when your faith.
Is really put to the test.
Is really put to the test.
The mountain
is your God in the valley.
When things go wrong,
He'll make them right.
And the God of good times
is your God in the bad times.
God of the day,
He's still God in the
night. God of the day,
He's still God in the night. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. To God be the glory. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 I welcome everybody here on this platform with me today to share the word of God. As you know, my name is Esther Online Kadia. I'm an evangelist of the Lord, and I greet you all. Happy Sunday. It is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and we'll be glad in it. I welcome you all to my platform. I welcome you onto my platform. Jesus Christ is my message prophetic ministry. Amen, amen, hallelujah. Please, as you join, help me share. As we share the word of God on this platform tonight about what God is trying to bring attention to. As you see on the title of this message, is titled that let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Everything that has breath. That is God saying to us that as long as you are a living being, you should have cause to praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm going to start off by reading the book of Psalm 150. Psalm 150, if you have your Bible, please open up to Psalm 150 and read along with me. It says, praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with stringed instruments and organs. Praise him upon the loud cymbals. Praise him upon the high sounding cymbals. Let everything that had breath praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. The message I have that I bring to us today is titled, Praise Ye the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Before I go, I would like to say a word of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, in the name of Jesus, in the mighty name of Jesus, everlasting King of glory, Jehovah, King of kings and Lord of lords, our Lord and our Savior, maker of heaven and earth, our Redeemer, and the love of our life, the lover of our soul. We thank you, God, for today. Thank you, God, for giving us the gift of seeing this day, this Sunday. It is a day that you made, Lord. We'll rejoice and be glad in it. We thank you because you have said today, even before it came to pass today. Father, Lord, receive our thanks in Jesus' name. Being alive today to witness today is not by mistake. It is by your divine plan. Lord Almighty, we thank you that we here alive today are part of your divine plan. Father, Lord, thank you for counting us worthy to still breathe, to be alive. Father, receive our thanks in the name of Jesus. Our Lord and our God, I'm about to go into your word. Father, Lord, I pray that you mold me as a clay in your hands and use me, oh God, as your vessel to speak forth the word from your throne of grace. What you have for us, let it come forth from my mouth in the name of Jesus. Father, Lord, it is not me speaking, but you, oh God. I decree so that you may increase me in the name of Jesus. Take charge, take hold, oh God, and speak forth through me in Jesus' name. That the word that cometh out of my mouth tonight, oh God, let it change lives. Let it touch lives in the name of Jesus. Let it rebuild lives in the name of Jesus. Father, Lord, have your way. Holy Spirit, I welcome you. I reverence you. Take charge as be my helper. Be my strength in the name of Jesus. Father, Lord, at the end of this message, both the speaker and the hearers shall never be the same again. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray. Amen, 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 in Jesus' name. The word I just shared with us is Psalm 150. And it talked about, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Everything that is alive, everything that is breathing, everything that is still able to be alive. It is imperative that that living thing praise the Lord. Amen. Like the song that we sang at the beginning of this message is a song of this God that is in the valley is still the same God that is on the mountaintop. He's God on both situations. He changed not. Whether you are in the valley or whether you are in the mountaintop, you are supposed to praise the Lord. Let everything that had breath praise the Lord. Whatever situation you may be, you may be going through the valley experience right now, you are supposed to praise the Lord. You may be on the mountaintop when everything is rosy, when everything is going smoothly, everything is so sweet. It is easy to talk about God and dance and tell how beautiful it is. You are supposed to praise the Lord. And when you are in the valley experience as well, when things are not going on smoothly, when you don't understand why some things are happening to you, when you may begin to be thinking to God and asking God in your heart, oh God, why me? Why me? Yes, it has to be you. It has to be you because it is for a purpose. It is for a reason. Praise the Lord in that valley. Because the same God that is on the mountaintop when things were rosy, it's still the same God in that valley that you are in right now. Praise ye the Lord. Praise him. Praise him. Just give him praise. Hallelujah. I tell you that when you are in the valley, is the best time to praise the Lord. The valley experience. Why is it the best time to praise the Lord? The best time to praise the Lord is when the valley experience come, when trials and tribulations come, when problems of life comes, when the winds and the turbulence of life, when it accosts you, when you feel the tempest of life and you don't know what to do, praise the Lord. Because it is at that time, first of all, at that time, that is the valley experience. When troubles come and you don't know the way out. When troubles come and you don't know the situation, the solution, even as at then when it comes. That is the valley experience. When you can solve that problem, it is not a valley experience yet. Because it is still within your power to resolve. But when it is beyond you, when you don't know why this happened to you, when you don't know the first thing to do to resolve that issue, that is the valley experience. And the valley experience, I'm going to tell us a few things that we should know regarding the valley experience. That valley experience, that's the time you know who you are. That is the time you know who you are, who you really are. That is the time you know it. That is the time you get a glimpse of revelation of yourself. Who are you really? This problem has happened. This problem has started. But how do you feel about that problem? What are your thoughts regarding that problem? Are you able to resolve that problem? Is that problem causing you sleepless nights? What are your actions regarding that problem? That is when you know you yourself, who you really are. The valley experience reveals to you who you really are. You get a revelation of yourself. Your action, your reaction in that valley is revealing to you who you are. Are you strong to withhold the tempest, the tribulations of life? Are you strong enough to stand? Are you strong enough to look beyond that problem? Are you strong enough to say to that mountain to move? Are you strong enough to say to that problem that that problem is not as great as your God? That is when you know you get a revelation of yourself, of your stand spiritually, of your faith. That is when you know the faith that you carry. When you are all down and weeping and gnashing your teeth and wailing and sorrowful and crying, then you know that you are not strong enough. That is a revelation of yourself. When you are in the valley, you know what you are made of. You know what your spiritual package is. You know what your strength. That is when you know it. When you are in the valley, another thing that the Valley Express teaches, when you are in the valley, that is the time you move closer to Christ. That is when you know him more. When you are in the valley, as you get a revelation of yourself, as you know who you are, as you know your strengths and your weaknesses, as you know whether you are panicking or whether you are afraid or whether you are still holding on to God and still hopeful that he will arise for you. At that time, whatever revelation of yourself you catch, whether your faith is that low, or whether you are a woman or a man of faith, whatever revelation you catch, that is the time to pray and move closer to God. That is the time that you need to move closer to God. You need to get close to your Creator. You need to know the God that you serve. That is when you begin to know this Christ, because that is when you will seek him, because that situation is beyond you. You need Jesus Christ for that situation. You need the intervention of God to resolve that problem, to get out of that problem, to get out of that tribulation, to move out of that valley, to get out of that bondage, to get out of the chains that has chained you down. You begin to move closer to God. And you know, it's just like marriage. When you move closer to somebody, you begin to understand them more. You begin to know them more. You begin to know their likes, their dislikes, what they love to eat, when they love to sleep, the clothes they love to wear, and their demeanor, their feelings. It's the same thing. When you begin to move close to God, you will begin to learn more about Christ. And also, that is the time you will experience the power of God, because he himself will now come into that situation. As you seek him, he will come into that situation and it will be your strength. Hallelujah. That is the valley experience. He will come into that situation. He will land into that storm that you are passing through. He will land inside it, right in the midst of the storm. God will land on it as you call on him. Hallelujah. That is the time you grow spiritual muscles. As you call on God, as you know this God, as your faith increases, your spiritual muscles increase. We have muscles physically, and we also have spiritual muscles. The muscles of battle, the muscles of faith, are spirit man. That is when we increase. That is when we enlarge. That is when we grow in the spirit as we move closer to God. Hallelujah. It is the time for your spiritual promotion and elevation, because you don't go through the valley for no reason. There's always a reason for you going through that valley. That is when you attain spiritual promotion. That is when you grow. That is when you get to your next level. That is what the passageway to your increase, to your promotion, to your enlargement, spiritually and physically. Hallelujah. That valley experience. That is also when you attain more confidence in Christ Jesus. That is when you know the God that you serve. Nobody can come and be telling you the God that you serve, because that valley experience has showed you that you serve a living God. You serve a God that changes not. You serve a God that is all powerful. You serve a God that can do all things. You serve a God that nothing is impossible for him to do. That is when you know this God. That is when you get closer to him. That is when you gain more confidence in him, because that valley experience is teaching you to trust in God. And it's as you hold on to Christ, Christ is carrying you in his hands, and you are not dashing your feet against a stone. In that valley experience, he is showing you his love. He's encompassing you with his presence. He has kept you in his pavilion, and no evil is coming near you. In spite of what is going on around you, it shall not touch you. He said, nothing broken, nothing missing. That, and as you begin to go through that valley experience and you come out of it unscattered, nothing missing, nothing broken, that is when you can say of a truth as serve a living God. That is when you grow more confidence in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I tell you, God teaches you new things when you go through the valley. There's a purpose for going through that valley. That valley is to teach you something new. It's to teach you something new. It's to take you to your next level. It's to take you to your next mission, to your next assignment. It's to take you closer to your destiny. That valley that you are in right now. You are not passing through that valley in vain. You are not passing through that valley for jokes. You are not passing through that valley just for passing through. It is for a purpose. It is for a reason. There is a purpose and there is a reason why you are passing through that valley. And I tell you that as you go through that valley and trust in him and hold on to Jesus, and he has sent and, you know, a camp around you and descend into that issue and resolve it, I tell you, I kid you not, immediately there is a promotion for you. You are soaring higher to another level, to the next level, to a greater level, to an increase and expansion, to an open door, to a blessing. There is always a blessing at the end of a valley. When you stay faithful, when you do not move left or right, when you do not doubt, there is always a blessing at the end of a valley experience. Hallelujah. Without tribulation, there cannot be testimony. Is there anybody that has ever given a testimony and not been tested? It is the test that gives rise to a testimony. The reason why there is a testimony is because you just went through some tests. The reason why you are able to testify is because you have just passed through a test and you passed the test. That is why you have a testimony. So without a tribulation, without a test, there cannot be a testimony. So it is always good that you experience the valley experience. It is always good that you go through this test. Do not run away from test. Do not run away from tribulation. Do not run away from the valley experience, because it gives rise, it gives birth to a testimony. It gives birth to a testimony gives birth to a promotion. It gives birth to an increase. It gives birth to a higher level. Do not run away from the valley experience. The God in the valley is still the same God on the mountain. When things go wrong, he will make them right. The God of the good times is still the same God of the bad times. He's still the same God. He changes not. He changes situation, but he changes not. The valley experience is a promotional experience. Do not fail. And when you hold on to Jesus, you cannot fail. You cannot fail. So it's always good to go through the valley experience. There's no human being that does not go through valley experience. If there's anybody that does not go through a valley experience, check your life. If there are no ups and downs in your life, if you are not experiencing some turmoil, some tribulation, some pandemonium, some tests, some valley experience, if you are not experiencing it, check your life. There is something amiss. There is something wrong. It is the valley experience that promotes you to your next level. It catapults you to your next level. If you do not ever go through valley experience and you are just having things smooth and you are just increasing and, you know, expanding and, you know, increasing and enlarging, check your life. That's a dangerous path to walk on. It's a dangerous path to ride on, because it can only lead to perish. It can only lead to destruction and perish. There must be a valley experience in every human being's life, in everyone that serves the Lord. The Bible says that in this world there are trials, there are tribulations, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Be of good cheer. Be of good cheer. Let us quickly go to the book of Romans 5. I want to tell you, my sister, rejoice in your tribulation. Rejoice. The main topic here is about praise. Rejoice. Praise God in your tribulation. The book of Romans 5. Please come with me. I want to read the book of Romans chapter 5. I'm going to start reading from verse 1. It says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. First of all, this peace of God is on inside of you. God's peace is in you, inside of you, telling you that all is well. First of all, that is the first gift he has given you. Immediately you give your life to Jesus, immediately you become born again, he first of all puts his peace on the inside of you. His peace comes on the inside of you. You experience a divine peace that passes all human understanding. So the book of Romans 5 verse 1 says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations. Not only so, verse 3, he said, and not only so, not only the peace of God that we have, not only the joy of God that we have, not only that we have access to faith, that we are full of faith. The verse 3 says, and not only so, but we glory in tribulation. Glory in tribulation. Glory in your valley experience. Knowing that that tribulation worketh patience. That tribulation you are in, it worketh patience. And patience, experience, and experience, hope. That tribulation you are in, it mentioned three things that it does for you. That tribulation, that valley experience you are in, it worketh patience. It first of all teach you how to persevere. Have long suffering, how to be patient until God comes in and intervene. Because God will always come in at the right time as long as you call on him. God does not just do his thing like that. Sometimes he does it like that, and sometimes he does it at the right time. But remember, God is never in a hurry and is never too late. He will never come into that situation too late. You can never say, oh God, you could have come earlier. Now it's too late. Even when Lazarus died and they thought it was too late, he was still in time. Because guess what happened? Lazarus rose up again. Hallelujah. God will come. He will appear to that situation at the right time. So he say that you will develop patience. You'll be patient for God. Just keep praying with long suffering. Be patient on God. Wait on God. Have faith in that God. Believe that he will do it. You have called on him. You are walking in his precepts. You have faith in him. You are calling on him alone. You look unto him alone. He's the one that finishes your faith. He's the one that crowns that faith. You will develop patience. You will learn to wait on God. You will learn to believe in him and wait on him to do that miracle. Remember that even at the Red Sea, he parted the Red Sea. Even at the Red Sea, when the people looked back and forth and they said which way to go, he still arose. He landed in that situation and he parted the Red Sea. He will come at the right time. He will come. Hallelujah. So you will develop patience, then experience. You will have experience in him. Experience that God is a God that changes not. He is really, really who he says he is. He is a deliverer. He is a healer. He is a maker. He is a lover. He is a creator. He is a blesser. He fights your battle. He is a fighter for your sake. He is a protector. He is a provider. He renews, he restores. You will get the experience of who God is in that valley, in that tribulation. You will get experience. So you, again, it says, I'm going to read, summarize again. In verse 4, it says, you will have patience, you will develop experience, and then experience in hope. Patience, experience, and hope. The Bible says Christ is in hopes, the hope of glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And verse 5 of that same chapter, I'm reading Romans 5, 1 to 5. Verse 5 says, and hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. Hallelujah. So rejoice in your tribulation. Rejoice in that valley. Praise ye the Lord. Praise him anyway. Praise him for that period that you are going through that. Praise him. Because I kid you not, you shall experience breakthrough. You will experience blessing from that tribulation. That valley experience. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. He will always be by your side, because you have a very big God. He's a deliverer, he's a restorer. He will nurture you, he will protect you from every dart of the enemy. He will send his angels to take charge over you. No evil will come near your place. Thousands will fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, they won't come near you because of the God that you serve. Hallelujah. You will not lose anything, and anything you lose, count it all joy also, because you lost it for Christ's sake. Know that a better one is coming. Let us go to the book of Philippians. Philippians 3, 8 to 10. Philippians 3, 8 to 10. Philippians 3, 8 to 10. Philippians 3, 8 to 10 says, yeah, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, from whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. That means he's saying that everything that I have lost, I count them as nothing. I count them as useless. I count them as inconsequential. I count them as unimportant compared to Christ, the love of Christ that I have gained. The blessings of Christ that I've gained. The presence of Christ that I have. Hallelujah. Count it all joy. Verse 9 goes to say, I'm befound in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. Hallelujah. The righteousness which is of God by faith. And verse 10 of that same scripture, Philippians 3, I'm reading verse 10 now, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. That is the Christ that we serve. That is the joy in knowing Christ. Anything that you may lose in your valley experience, count it all joy. Count them non-consequential. Count them unimportant, because God is going to give you a greater blessing. He's a God, he's a restorer. And when he restores, he does not restore on the same level. He restores on a greater level, on an increased level, increased measure. He said, good measure, press down, shake it together. That is how he restores back to you. Anything you lose as you stand firm in Christ, in that your wilderness experience, is not in vain. Count it unimportant. The love of God, the love of Christ, Christ is in, that is in you, the Christ that you look up to, that is the most important. And the Bible says that as you seek first Christ, his kingdom, every other thing shall be added unto you. Every other thing shall be added unto you. Christ is in you, the hope of glory. Let us start see many people, few people that went through trials and they were able to praise God in that trial, in that tribulation. Don't forget, the topic I'm talking about is praise God. Let every living thing, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Even in your valley experience, praise the Lord. In your valley experience, praise the living Jesus. Praise it. Praise it. No matter what the situation may be. Let us go into the book of 1 Samuel and read about Hannah. Let us go to 1 Samuel chapter 14. 1 Samuel chapter 14. Let us go into 1 Samuel chapter 14. 1 Samuel chapter 14. This is Hannah. This is Hannah here. Let's see what happened to her. We all know the story about Hannah, that she was without child for a very long time. And her rival, Penina, had children. And Penina used to mock her and make jest of her that she had no child. And there was this very time when every year they go to Shiloh to pray to God and bring offerings unto the Lord. This very year, the whole family, Elkanah, Hannah, and Penina, the two wives of Elkanah, went up to Shiloh as they usually do every year to do this. And Hannah stayed back and began to pray to God. She began to pray to her God regarding her situation, regarding her childlessness. While she was praying, I read from verse 13. I'm reading 1 Samuel chapter 1. I'm going to start reading from verse 13. It says, now Hannah, she speak in her heart. Hannah was speaking in her heart. Only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. She was speaking in her heart. She was in the temple alone, all by herself. She was pouring out her heart to the Lord about what she wanted, about her childlessness situation, so that Penina and people will stop mocking her. Her father, I pray that whatever it is that people are mocking you, whatever it is in your life that is causing people to mock you, today is the last day that it will, that you will see it in Jesus' name. God is taking them all away. From today, you shall express a testimony regarding that in Jesus' name. This is a situation that Anna found herself, childlessness. And people were mocking her. Peninnah was mocking her. And she stayed back in Shiloh and prayed unto the Lord. And while she was praying, her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. She was praying in her heart. Therefore, Eli thought she had been drunken. Eli, the chief priest, thought she was drunken. Eli saw her and thought she was drunken. And Eli said unto her, how long wilt thou be drunken? Put away thy wine from thee. And Anna answered and said, no, my lord, I am a woman of a sorrowful spirit. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but have poured out my soul before the Lord. Count not thy handmaid for a daughter of Belial, for out of the abundance of my complaint and grief have I spoken thereto. Did you hear what she said there? She said that she is a woman of sorrowful spirit. Her heart was full of sorrow in that valley experience. In that her valley experience, she was filled with sorrow. So she said that she's not a daughter of Belial, she's not a drunkard, but it was from the abundance of complaint and grief that she has spoken. She was filled with abundance of complaint and abundance of grief in her valley experience. But I said that even in your valley experience, you should rejoice, you should praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. And verse 17 says, then Eli answered and said, go in peace, and God of Israel grant thee thy petition that thou hast asked of him. Go in peace. The God of Israel grants you the petition that you have asked of him. Verse 18 says, let thy handmaid find grace in thy sight. So the woman went away and did eat, and her countenance was no more sad. So when Eli told her that go, your request is being made, is being answered, she now went. She wasn't eating before, because the Bible says now she did eat. She was so sorrowful, she was not eating. And now it says she did eat, and her countenance was no more sad. She was no more carrying a very sad, long-faced countenance. We're talking about Hannah here. She was no longer sad. She changed her countenance. She changed her demeanor. She decided to be joyful. She decided to be happy. She decided to put aside the problem and look unto God alone. And verse 19 says, and they rose up in the morning early and worshipped before the Lord, and returned and came to their house to Ramah, and Elkanah knew Hannah his wife, and the Lord remembered her. You know why the Lord remembered her? Because she worshipped. I will read verse 19 again. And they rose up in the morning early and worshipped before the Lord. They worshipped the Lord. They praised the Lord. They sang to the Lord. They worshipped the Lord. Hallelujah. Hori basika la basia. They worshipped the Lord. And then they returned home. And because of that worship, because of that countenance, because of that joyfulness in her heart, because she decided to shed away the sorrow, the grief, the abundance of complaint to the Lord, because she decided to shove that aside and decide to look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of her faith, and she decided to be joyful and merry in the Lord, God answered her. There is victory in praise. There is victory in praise. There is victory when you praise the Lord in that valley that you are, in that valley experience, where you are, that valley that you are in right now. When you praise the Lord, there is victory in that praise. Hallelujah. That God decided to bless her with a child. The Bible says, and they rose up in the morning early and worshipped before the Lord. When you worship, you praise the Lord. And returned and came to their house to Ramah. And Elkanah knew his wife, Anna. And the Lord remembered her. And she gave birth to a child, Samuel. Hallelujah. That is God in action. When you praise him, when you praise him in that valley, when you decided not to focus your attention on that problem, but you focus on Jesus Christ, the author and the finisher of your faith, when you decide to show that mountain, that problem, that your God is bigger than that problem, then the problem will shift because you are not focusing on it. Christ has taken the place of that focus. Christ has replaced that picture you are looking at. You are no longer looking at the picture and the problem. You are looking at Christ. And when you look at Christ, you cannot see the problem no more, because Christ is greater than the problem. So therefore, because she decided to focus on Christ, her problem was resolved. And she had a child. Hallelujah. And she gave birth to a child. Let us look at another life of who it is that went through issues, but God arose for their sake. Let us look at the life of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We knew what happened during the days of Nebuchadnezzar. And Nebuchadnezzar created a golden image. And he requested everyone in the province, in the nation, in Babylon, to worship the golden image. At that time, we all know that the children of Israel were captured by the Babylonians. They were sojourning in Babylon. And they were subjected to the Babylonians to obey the king. So when the king created this golden image, I requested everybody to worship this golden image, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego refused to worship, to bow down to the golden image. They said to the king, "We shall not worship the golden image." He said, and the king threatened that he will punish them, he will put them in the furnace of fire to be roasted. They said to the king that even if you put us in, we believe that our God is able to deliver us from your hand. But even if he doesn't, we will not bow to the golden image. Because they know the God that they serve. They defied the king and they said, "We will not bow this our head to a graven image, an image that cannot talk, an image that cannot save itself, an image that cannot walk, an image that cannot do anything, that cannot hear, he cannot speak, he cannot see, he cannot do nothing. We will not bow down to that, because we serve a God that can talk. We serve a God that can see. We serve a God that can move. We serve a God that can move mountain. We serve a God that's reigning above every other God. We serve a God that created the heavens and the earth. We serve a God that commanded everything into being. We serve a God that is capable of killing or making alive. We serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Why should we bow down to a mere golden image when we have a great God, a mighty God?" So they said, even if he does not deliver us, we will not serve you. We will not bow down to your golden image. And what happened? We all know the story. God, Nebuchadnezzar commanded his men to kindle the fire 7 times more and put them in the fire. We all know the story. If you want to read the story, go to the book of Daniel. Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3. He said, "Rekindle the fire 7 times and put them in the fire. When they put them in the fire, first of all, the gods that put them in the fire, they were all consumed by the fire. They died. Because they kindled the fire so much, it was so hot, that those that went to put them in the fire all were consumed by the fire. And when they now put them, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego into this fire, what happened? They were singing and dancing in the fire. It did not burn them. Hallelujah. It did not burn them. Hallelujah. They were rejoicing in the Lord. And what happened? Christ himself joined them in that fire. So instead of three men in the fire, there were four men. Let us read it. Daniel 3, I'm going to read quickly verse 28 and 29. Let us go to the book of Daniel. Please follow me to the book of Daniel. Follow me to the book of Daniel. Daniel chapter 3, I'm going to read verse 28. First of all, let me read verse 25 for you. This was after the king put them in the fire. Verse 25 says, he answered and said, "Lo, I see four men loose walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt, nothing to hurt them. And the form of the fourth is like the Son of God." So it's not only the three that were in the furnace of fire. There was a fourth one that looks like the Son of God. Even King Nebuchadnezzar, the evil king that created the golden image, that doesn't even know this God, he was able to recognize the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ. He said he looks like the Son of God. I tell you, your tribulation will bring all believers to the feet of Christ. The tribulation you are passing through, if you wait with long suffering, you persevere, you look unto God, you pray to him, you rejoice and praise him in that valley, you will bring the unbelievers to the feet of Christ. Hallelujah. The king said, "It looks like the Son of God." And then he told them to remove them from the furnace of fire. Verse 28 says, then Nebuchadnezzar spake and said, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who had sent his angels and delivered his servants that trusted in him, and have chained the king's words and yielded their bodies, that they might not serve nor worship any god except their own God." Hallelujah. And then he further said in verse 29, "Therefore," this is the king Nebuchadnezzar speaking, "therefore I make a decree that every people, nation, and language which speak anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut in pieces, and their houses shall be made a dunghill, because there is no other God that can deliver after this sort, after this manner. There is no other God that can descend into a bad situation and deliver a man like this that I've witnessed. There is no other God that can do this except the real God, except the mighty God, except the King of Kings and the Lord of God, Lord, except the only one God that can do this. No other God can do this. Even this graven image that I created and requested everybody to bow before cannot do this." King Nebuchadnezzar recognized that there is only one God that is above every other God, our Lord and our Savior. Hallelujah. You can bring unbelievers to the feet of Christ through your valley experience. Just praise him. Let everything that had breath praise the Lord. As long as you are alive, you should praise the Lord. The fact that you can breathe, it's a fact that you should praise him, because it's not of your making that you were able to be alive. It's not of your making that you were able to wake up in the morning. When you open your eyes in the morning, it's not by your power. It is by the love of God, the love of Christ. It's because Christ still loves you and you still have a mandate to fulfill. Don't just wake up in the morning and then just fling your hands and just say a word of prayer, maybe two or three sentences, and then you move on and begin your day. Thank him that woke you up. Many went to bed, they didn't wake up. Praise the Lord all situations. When you are happy, praise him. When you feel sorrowful in your heart, praise him. When you feel down, praise him. When you feel you are drowning in the troubles of life, praise him. Don't lose your focus on God. Shift your focus from that problem and focus on Christ. Focus on the cross. Hallelujah. And you will ascend into your situation. When you focus on God, when you praise him, when you praise God, let me tell you one thing. When you pray, you can shift the hand of God. When you pray, you draw the attention of God. When you pray, God listens to you. Yes, he listens. And he sends his angels to attend to you. When you pray, but when you praise God, he descends into your midst. Into that situation. Rainbow Huriba Sinkalaba. Rainbow Rahiba Hinkaba. Hurilobobo Santa Rebasia. God himself would descend into that situation, into that valley, into that place, that trouble place, that storm of life, that trouble, that thing that is troubling you, that is bothering you, into that thing that has captivated you, that has chained you down. God will descend into it. And he will set you free. And he will set you free. Praise bring down the hand of God. He descend into your midst. When you praise him, he will descend into your problem. He will descend into your midst. When you pray, you shift his hand. You draw his attention. He listens to you. He's looking at you. He's listening. Yes, and he's answering your problem, your request. But when you praise God, he will get up and come into that situation. He will land into that problem you are. Into that valley is there with you. He was in the furnace of fire with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Where you praise him. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let us look at another example. Let us go to the book of let us look at the example of Paul and Silas in Philippi. When they went to Philippi to preach, they went out and they were preaching the gospel all around, and they got to Philippi. They were preaching the word of God in Philippi. Please come with me to the book of Acts chapter 16. Let us go quickly to the book of Acts chapter 16. I'm going to be reading verse 22 right now. Acts chapter 16. In Philippi, something had happened in Philippi. Paul and Silas, they were preaching. They were sharing the word of God. And the people around got angry with them, and they decided to get them into trouble, to get them arrested. So they reported them to the authorities, and they arrested Paul and Silas and kept them in prison. Verse 22 says, I'm reading Acts chapter 16. I'm reading from verse 22. And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates rent off their clothes and commanded them to be beaten. They beat up Paul and Silas, and when they laid many stripes on them, verse 23, they cast them into the prison, charging the jailer to keep them safe. So they beat them on and they put them in prison. They put Paul and Silas in the prison. They didn't do anything wrong. They were just preaching the word of God. That is what angered them, because they were preaching the word of God. They were preaching the word of God. Hallelujah. And the people got mad at them, and they decided to get them into trouble, and they reported them to the authorities, and they cast them into, and they beat them up mercilessly and put them in prison. And verse 24 said, who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and make their feet fast in the stocks. So they put them in the inner prison, not even in the outer part, in the inner prison, so that they will not escape. They chained them down and they bind them down in the prison. And for nothing, they didn't do nothing. They were accused wrongly. The enemies just wanted to see their end. The enemies just wanted to destroy them. Hallelujah. But they were doing the work of God. And the Bible recorded in verse 25. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. And suddenly, hallelujah, and suddenly, there was a great earthquake, so that the foundation of the prison was shaking, and immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's bands was loosed. At midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises. They praised the Lord. They praised the Lord. Get that? They praised the Lord. What did Paul and Silas do? They praised the Lord. They had been beaten for no reason. They were beaten mercilessly. Stripes all over them. And they were charged into the prison. They were chained. They were chained for no reason. They didn't do anything wrong. But instead of wallowing in self-pity, instead of crying and weeping, instead of being filled with so much sorrow and abundance of complaints, they praised the Lord. The Bible recorded in verse 25 of Acts 16, it said at midnight, Paul and Silas, they prayed and sing praises unto God. And the prisoners heard them. The prisoners heard them. And suddenly, there was a great earthquake. Hallelujah. When God descended to your situation, there must be a great earthquake. Nothing can withstand the power of God. When it comes, everywhere must know that the Lord has landed. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaking. The foundation of the prison was shaking when God landed. And immediately all doors were opened and everyone's hands were loosed. All doors were opened and everyone's hands were loosed. It, as they praised the Lord, as they praised the Lord, as the Paul and Silas in jail where they were confined to death, as they were cast away to be destroyed, as they were supposed to be they were supposed to be thinking that all hope is lost, they were supposed to give up hope. But what happened? Rather than giving up hope, they got up at midnight and they praised the Lord. They prayed, they danced, and they praised the Lord. And what happened? Suddenly, verse 26 says, suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundation of the prison shook. And immediately all doors were opened, and everyone's hands was loosed. And the keeper of the prison, awaking out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had fled. He was going to kill himself, thinking all the prisoners had fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, "Do thyself no harm, for we are all here." Don't kill yourself. We are here. We are not run away. You think we are the one that broke down all the doors? You think we are the one that caused this earthquake? You think we are the one that lose the chains that you used to bind us? We serve a living God. And he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling, and he fell down. This is the prison guard. And he fell down before Paul and Silas, because he was amazed. He himself was seeing the power of God right in front of his eyes. He himself knew that something unusual had happened that no man can do. This is beyond what man can do. It's only God that can do this. And he called, the Bible says, this prison guard called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" He knew that there was a God behind these people. There is a greater one behind them. He knew that there is a greater one on the inside of them. He knew that there is something peculiar about them. He knew that there was something backing them up. that is so great and mighty than any human power. And he knew that there is a God somewhere. And he wanted to know this God. So he said, what do I do to be saved? And they said, this Paul and Silas, they said to this God, when he asked that question, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house, in the name of Jesus. So I say to you, my brethren, my brothers and my sister, believe in God, in Christ the Savior, and you will be saved. Praise ye the Lord. Let everything that had breath praise the Lord. Praise God when you're on the mountaintop. Praise God when you are in your valley experience. Praise God when you are in that tribulation. Praise God when the wind of tempest is blowing against you. Just praise God when you are able to keep, if you can keep your eyes away from the wind, if you can keep your eyes away from that tribulation, if you can keep your eyes away from that valley that you are in, and just look up to Jesus and just face God, you will be able to praise him. And when you praise God, he descends into your situation. He will descend right there and then. There shall be an earthquake. There shall be a shaking. There shall be a release. Doors will open of his own accord. And chains will be broken of his own accord. And you will come out unscathed. Nothing missing, nothing broken. Your God is a God of restoration. And he will restore all that you have lost during that tempest, during that valley experience. He will restore it back unto you a double fold. He will replenish you. He will take care of you. He will restore you. He will lift you up and he will promote you. Remember, I said that valley experience is a promotional exam. It's a promotional experience. It will propel you to a greater level. It will open greater doors of increase unto you. Greater levels in your, even in your spiritual walk. It will lift you up, increase you spiritually, promote you spiritually. You develop spiritual muscles even to combat the enemy and destroy the camp of darkness. You will become the terror to the kingdom of darkness as you praise the Lord in all situations. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. You cannot miss it. When you praise God in any situation, you can never miss it. Praise is the key. Praise him for all situations. Thank him, praise him. Dance, don't forget to pray. You pray, but praise him. Dance, acknowledge him as your Lord and Savior. Appreciate him. Thank him for what he has done, even for keeping you alive. If you are not alive, you cannot be in the valley experience. Those that have been in that same valley experience, they have come out unscathed. They have come out in glory. They have come out with testimonies. Yours will be likewise, even greater, in the name of Jesus. Just believe and praise him. Let everything that had breath praise the Lord. That valley experience is a testing ground. It's a promotional exam to a greater level. Do not fail. Do not lose focus on Jesus, because it's an opportunity for God to promote you. Remember, I said that count it all joy when you pass through different tribulation, because it is a situation that will reveal the power that is in Christ, our Lord and Savior, your Redeemer, your God. It will be revealed unto you. That's where you get to know him more. That's where you get to get closer to him. That's where you develop a love bond, a deeper love bond with God when you are in that valley experience. It's a period of blessing. Do not discard it. Do not reject it. Do not run away from it. Appreciate it. Enjoy it. And look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith. Praise the Lord in any situation, and it shall be well with you and I. It shall be well with you in the name of Jesus. Give your life to Jesus today. If you don't know Christ, this is the time to give your life to him. Because when you give your life to Jesus, you'll be able to go through the valley experience unscathed. You'll be able to come out unscathed with testimonies. It is Jesus that can help you with the challenges of life. It is Jesus that can keep you and hold you, and you will not stumble. You will not kick your feet against a stone. It is Christ Jesus. You need Jesus today. Give your life to Him. Tomorrow may be too late. He is a lover of your soul. He loves you even more than you love yourself. The Bible says that for this reason, He came and He died on the cross. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that He gave His one and only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. Believe. Praise the Lord. Praise Him. Rejoice. When you have in abundance, rejoice. When you are in lack, rejoice. Praise the Lord. When you are in need, praise Him. That need will come, it will just surface, it will appear. God will meet you at the point of your needs. He will never leave you. He will never discard you. He will not leave you uncared for. He will provide. If He can provide for the ravens, the birds of the air, how much more you? He loves you. If a father knows how to give good gifts to their children, how much more God, our Heavenly Father? If a mere mortal man, a man made of sand, knows how to give good gifts to their children. If you and I know how to give good gifts to our children, how much more the God that you serve, that maketh all things, that can create all things, that can make a way where there is no way, how much more will He give you if you just put your trust in Him? Praise Him. When you are down with illness, praise Him. He will get you out of that bondage of illness when you praise Him. Hallelujah. Praise ye the Lord. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. And I pray, Father, in the name of Jesus, that all that are here with me, that have heard this word, I pray, Lord, that you give us the spirit of praise, to praise you at all times, to praise you when we are in lack, when we are in need, to praise you, when we are in a valley, to praise you, to learn to look unto you, the author and the finisher of our faith. Father, Lord, I pray that you open the eyes of everyone that will listen to this, that has listened and will listen to this message, to see you and to see your glory. Oh, Lord, my God, appear to them. Let them know the God that you are. Let them know that you are a loving God. Let them know that what trials and tribulations they are passing through is of a short term, because the Bible says that 20 tears may endure for a night, but joy always comes in the morning. So that tribulation is just for a short time. Tribulation does not last forever. Lord, teach us, teach them to know this. Teach them to keep their focus on you, because that tribulation is just temporal. You are eternal, Lord. Let them know to seek you, to seek eternal life, to come for you, Lord, to hear your word, to yearn for you in the name of Jesus. Father, Lord, I pray that you teach us, oh Lord, to appreciate you at every step of our life, to know that it is by your making that we are even able to wake up in the morning. We're able to go to bed and sleep till dawn. It is only by your power and your grace. Father, Lord Almighty, give us a spirit of David to always rejoice in you, to learn to dance and praise your holy name in all situations, oh Lord. Father, Lord, I pray that some souls that are out there that are ashamed even to say that they are Christians, that are ashamed even to preach the word, to share the word with their loved ones, with their friends, with their colleagues, Father, Lord, give them the boldness to be able to come out of that shame and be able to speak for the word of life and share the word with their family members, so that they can also experience your blessings, your greatness, your power and your glory in their lives as well, in the name of Jesus. Father, Lord Almighty, I pray that, oh Lord, that you are waking all souls of the world, every human, oh Lord, pour your spirit upon every man, so that they can hope to see you, oh God, so that they can see you, oh God, they can do your will, Father, in the name of Jesus. From the head of the nation to the most little, to the little child that was born, Father, pour your spirit upon each and every one, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Father, teach us to rejoice as a nation. Teach us to rejoice and praise you in our homes, in our family homes. Teach us to rejoice and praise you, Lord. When we praise, when we rejoice as a nation, as families, God will descend into the situation of the nation, into the troubles of the nation. He will resolve it. He is a God that loves the praises of his people. The primary reason why he created you and I is to praise him. He is to worship him. Father Lord, let every soul realize the power behind the praise, and let them know that that's the reason why we are kept alive. The primary reason why. Every other thing that we seek, when we speak, seek promotion, good job, households, is secondary. Children, everything is secondary. Our primary reason is to serve God, is to worship God, is to praise the Lord. Father, let people realize this. Let them know this. Let the dawn on them. Give them a revelation. Let them catch the rhema in that name of Jesus. Let them catch the rhema in that name of Jesus. Because when we praise you, every other thing will follow. When we praise you, doors that have been locked will open. In that name of Jesus, let every door that have been locked onto everyone tonight, let them begin to open of his own accord. In the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray that everyone that has been held captives in chains and in bonds, I command those chains to break loose right now. In the name of Jesus. Lord, I speak to every womb, just like you answered Hannah when Hannah praised you. I command every womb that's to come alive. Every womb that the doctor has pronounced dead. Every womb that is yet to carry children. That the womb is still looking for the fruit of the womb. I speak forth the seed of life into that womb today. Receive it in the name of Jesus. Holy Messiah. I decree and I declare that when your husband shall know you, there shall be seed planted and the seed shall grow and germinate in the name of Jesus. I prophesy to that womb, receive the fruits of life. Begin to carry a child and not a child. And in 9 months' time, you shall give it to birth. You shall bring it to birth. You shall bring birth a full grown child in the name of Jesus. I pray that everybody that's looking unto you for anything in their life, Father, Lord Almighty, I pray that you meet them at the point of their knees, oh God, so that they can know that they serve a living God. In the name of Jesus, Father, Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus, those that thought that they have lost for your sake, those that thought that they have lost because they stood firm in you, Jesus, Father, Lord, you are the God of restoration. Father, restore them back unto them 100 fold in the name of Jesus. Father Lord, some are calling unto you now. Some are seeking your face. Some are looking unto you for one thing or the other. Father, descend into their midst right this moment, oh God. Answer them. Answer them. That's what I'm hearing. That you are ready to answer prayers. That you are ready to inhabit the presence of your people. In the name of Jesus. Father, Lord Almighty, I pray that you visit every home, visit every home, visit every community in our nation, visit the nation as a whole, in the name of Jesus, visit Nigeria, do a new things in our lives, in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray that you Father Lord, lead your people to the cross. Lead your people to the cross. Let them know you. Let them find their way to the cross. I know you and worship you in spirit and in truth. And praise your name. And praise your name. And praise your name. In the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray that, oh Lord, in this dispensation, in this generation, Father, Lord, I pray, oh, that you depopulate the kingdom of hell. Father, depopulate the kingdom of hell, oh Lord, and let the hell kingdom of heaven begin to be populated. Let it begin to be populated in the name of Jesus. Every candidate on their way to hell, Father, Lord, I pray that you make them to do a turnaround and focus on the cross, and focus on the cross. They shall not be heaven in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray that you visit everybody, visit every home, inhabit the praise of your people, Lord. Give everyone the spirit, the heart of praise to praise you in their need, to praise you in their lack, to praise you in the valley. Because that is when you begin your miracle. That is where you begin your miracle. Father Lord, come and do this. Like you did for Paul and Silas. Like you did for Hannah after she praised you. You blessed her with Samuel. Like you did, oh Lord, my God, for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You became the third man, the fourth man in the furnace of fire. Father, come and do likewise to your people. Assign into our midst, into our problems, into our tribulations, into our valley. In that name of Jesus. Let people begin to focus on you, Jesus, rather than focusing on their tribulation, rather than focusing on the valley. Let them shift their focus to you. Teach people to always look unto you. You are the author and the finisher of our faith. Father, do this, oh God, and all glory, honor, and adoration shall be given unto you forever and ever. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen, 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 in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I thank you all for joining me. I praise your holy name. I praise the name of the Lord. I praise the name of the Lord for giving us this day to be able to come before his presence, to be able to worship him, to talk about him, to learn at his feet. I give God all the glory in the name of Jesus. Thank you all for joining, and have a blessed week. Have a fruitful week. Have a very, very victorious week this week in Jesus' name. Have a testimony-packed week. Praise the Lord this week. Try it. Praise the Lord in that situation, and you will see the heavens open up unto you. You will see God descend into your situation. You will see that problem resolved in the name of Jesus. Because the same God that is in the valley is still the same God on the mountaintop. He will take you through. He will see you through that valley. He will bring you to the mountaintop in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Have a blessed week in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Thank you all. Have a blessed week in Jesus' name. Amen.
God of the good times is still God in the valley.
day. He's still God in the night. The light of the day. He's still God in the night.
Thank you so much.